Since okay, so then let me begin. So what we learned last time is that if we consider Maxwell's theory, okay, that's P Maxwell's theory we're considering now. Then this object this is not a well-defined object, this is in fact divergent. Okay, because this after all is a gauge field propagator. And you have seen that the propagator is infinite because the kinetic term has operator has zero eigenvalues. However, we also argued at the same time that if we consider expectation values of gauge invariant operators, then that should be calculable. So, in particular, if we consider something like this, this one should be calculable. And what I mean by this is that this is a Fourier transform of F mu nu or F mu 1 nu 1 of x. So this in the momentum space will be something like I k mu 1 A tilde mu 1 of k 1 minus I k mu 1 A tilde mu 1. Okay, this is a Fourier transform of F mu. Okay. Because this doesn't transform under gauge transformation, okay, if you go through the arguments that I gave yesterday, last time, okay, we expect that this to be calculable. Okay, because this has no dependence on those flat directions. While this one is not calculable. Okay. So today we will see explicitly how we can go about actually doing this calculation. So this will just give a basic illustration of what is the kind of strategy that we'll be following, okay, and then we'll consider a more general case which will include interactions and so on. Yes, you can think of this as a time order product. Okay, the vacuum expectation of the time order products of operators up to contact terms. Okay. Because see whenever you have derivatives, right? There are additional contact terms because the derivatives when you take out of the time order product, right? What they can do is that they can act on the this theta, the step function, to give you some contact terms, right? So unless the times are equal, right, this has the same interpretation as vacuum expectation or the time order products. Right? For equal time, you have to add some extra correction terms. Okay, are there other questions? More importantly, once you can calculate vacuum expectation values of these objects, okay, you can use it to extract the S matrix. Okay, you can show that to extract the S matrix, normally you can start from here and try to extract the S matrix, but you can also do it from here. Okay, so let's then see how to go about calculating something like this, okay, avoiding the problem that we had faced earlier that the kinetic operator is not invertible. So for this, let's recall again that the problem was that the transformation, the gauge transformation of the Fourier transform of mu, this was I k mu
epsilon tilde of k. Right? This comes from delta mu of x equals del mu epsilon. Okay, this is the Fourier transform version of this,
which told us that this is a zero eigenvector. This is an eigenvector with zero eigenvalue of the kinetic operator. Okay, and this is a problematic situation because this direction is flat. So let's try to make this more explicit by choose for every k a set of four linearly independent basis vectors. Linearly independent four vectors. Okay. At this stage, you don't need to demand any orthonormality condition. Okay. The only condition we will impose is that one of these basis vectors should be this one. Okay, so let's say we take E1 mu as K mu. Okay, we are not worried about normalization, so let's keep it like this. Okay. And then we have E2 mu, E3 mu, and E4 mu. How we choose them will not affect the final result. Okay. So for example, you could choose this. So let me write this. If I can write this as k0 and vector k. This one I can take, for example, k0 and minus vector k. This is of course linearly independent of this. And these two I can take 0, e3. Okay. Where these are linearly independent vectors, which are also linearly independent from this vector k. Okay, so in particular, we can choose that k dot v3 is 0, so k dot v4. And then E3 and E4 are orthonormal. None of this is necessary. And we will not assume that we have chosen it this way when we proceed. Okay. All that we will have to assume is that these are linearly independent. Okay. So that any vector, any four vector, can be expressed as a linear combination of these four basis vectors. Okay. That's all we will assume. Is this okay so far? Okay, so let me emphasize again, for every four momentum, okay, we are choosing a set of four linearly independent vectors. Okay. The only demand we make is that one of those vectors, which I'm calling E1, is K mu. Okay. This is special because this is the zero eigenvalue. This is the eigenvector with zero eigenvalue. Okay, that's why you have separate like this.
So these basis vectors actually span the space of eigenvectors of the
because these are four independent basis vectors, they obviously span the space of eigenvectors of M, right? Any any eigenvector of M, after all, is expressible in terms of any vector, is expressible as a linear combination of these four, right? So in particular, the eigenvectors will also have that property. Okay. We are not demanding, for example, that these three are the other three eigenvectors of M. Right? That is not necessary. Only the first one is the one corresponding to zero eigenvalue. Okay, so now what we can do is that we can take A tilde mu of k. Okay, so for fixed k, of course, this is a four vector. And we can write this as a linear combination of
where these are some coefficients. Containing information on it is.
Tildas are just coefficients, they will also depend on momentum.
Pardon?
Tildas, they are coefficients, and they will also depend on momentum.
Yes, they could depend on momentum, because for defined momentum, you fix your momentum, right? Then you decompose in this basis, right? If you go to a defined momentum, it need not be the same functions, right? This could be different functions. So these are fixed. This is our choice. These are our choice, right? We fix them once and for all. We choose a set of vectors, S mu of k, and we are not going to change them. Now, the claim is that given any gauge field configuration, A tilde mu of k, we can always expand it in this basis. With these coefficients, containing the information about what the original A tilde mu.
These are just pure numbers, right?
These are just pure numbers.
So, as you change the case,
yes.
ES mu and B tilde mu both
can change. Both can change, yeah. How ES mu is changed, that is up to us. We have fixed it. Okay? You could have said that why not fix everything at independent of K, right? The only reason that we cannot do it is because of the fact that the first one, right, is proportional to K mu. Right? Other people choose them independent of K, right? As you are varying K mu, at some point this will become linear combination of the other three. Right? You can always choose K mu such that it becomes linear combination of other three. Right? That's the reason why you have to also let them be a function of K. Right? As you change your K, you better make sure that whatever these three are, right, that they never become linearly dependent on K. That's the only demand we make. Yeah, otherwise, of course, there's a lot of freedom. Is this clear? Okay, in particular, this is one choice that you can make. Okay, that for every k, okay, you identify two vectors like this, okay, and other two as transverse to the spatial components. So the idea now is that these we will think of as the independent degrees of freedom, okay, and the path integral over A mu I'll think of as integrals over these variables. These are change of variables. These are fixed numbers. Okay. It's as if for every k we are making a change of variables from A tilde mu, okay, which are four variables per k, to another four variables which are B tilde I sub k. Is that clear? So let's try to be a little more general. So if we had to do an integral, suppose you want to calculate some well, these are gauge invariant operators. I'll write an integral b a tilde mu k. Let me write integral product of a mu . This was the original definition, right? Which had problem because if you try to directly use this, okay, we are into problems. But what I'll do is that I'll now rewrite this as integral product over S
Okay, path integral, instead of integrating over a tilde mu, I am integrating over b tilde s. Now, the thing to notice is that when you change variables from a tilde mu to b tilde s, for every k, there is a Jacobian, which is this determinant of this 4 by 4 matrix. Right? Matrix labeled by s and mu. Right? S runs over 4 values, mu runs over 4 values. So, there is a Jacobian. But this is constant. This doesn't depend on b tilde s. So, whatever Jacobian you pick up, will cancel between the numerator and the denominator. Okay? Because it's a linear change in variable. Okay, if it has not a linear change in variables, then you have to avoid. Right? And we'll see later that we'll encounter situations where this change of variable is not linear. Okay, and you have to worry about the Jacobian. But at least for this case, we can just identify this as this. Is this clear? Okay, so far we have not done anything. Right? We have just taken the original integral, okay, change variables. And if the original integral had problem, we expect this also should have problem. But the advantage is that once you have written it this way, the source of the problem becomes more manifest. Okay, and that's what we'll try to see. Okay, where do we see that problem? Okay, in this language. So for this, let's remember this Gates transformation. So this was a transformation of a tilde mu k, but now we are not going to use a tilde mu k variables, we are using these variables. Okay, so you have to check what those transformation laws become in these variables. Right? The same transformation laws but written in terms of the b tilde s. So you use that relation to say that sum over s equal to 1 to 4 b tilde s delta b tilde s k es mu of k. These are of course kicks, right? You are not going to vary these. So this is given by I k mu epsilon theta k. But this now I can write as I times E1 mu epsilon theta k. Right? Because E1 mu by definition was k mu. So now let's compare the left hand side and the right hand side. E mu's are linearly independent. So you can equate the coefficients of each ES mu on both sides. So this tells us that delta B tilde 1 k is I epsilon tilde k and delta B tilde S k equal to 0. Or s equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. So all that we have achieved is that by this Gates change of variables, we have ensured that under a Gates transformation, only one of these four variables actually change. The others don't change. Okay, earlier all four variables are changing when you make a Gates transformation. Is this clear? Now we can see what it means for something to be gauge invariant. Right? If something is gauge invariant, that means that that thing doesn't change when you shift b tilde 1 by I epsilon tilde. But epsilon tilde is completely arbitrary. Okay? So if something doesn't change under a change of this kind, that basically means that it must be independent of b tilde 1. Right? Because you change b tilde by arbitrary amount and it doesn't change. So, since we know that the action is gauge invariant, so this shows that
when you make this change of variables and rewrite S in terms of the B's, this must be B tilde 1 independent. Similarly, each of these, okay, if these are gauge independent, they must be B tilde 1 independent. Is that clear? So this means that the integral over B tilde 1, that of course diverges. Right? There's nothing that depends on B tilde 1, right? It runs from minus infinity to infinity. So that's the source of the divergence. But that integral can be factored out from the rest of the integral, both in the numerator and the denominator. And that can then cancel. Okay, that's the way we will now define our new integrals, by cancelling the B tilde 1 integral between the numerator and the denominator. So if we do that,
the operators are still gauge invariant.
Yes. So if the Y's are not gauge invariant, right, then these will depend on B tilde 1. Right? Then you couldn't factor it out. Okay, but as long as O tilde is a gauge invariant, you can factor out B tilde 1. And you can write this
product over I, O tilde I ti, as a ratio integral
depends
on the A's, right?
Yes.
But if it's spatial, that it depends on the A's in a gauge invariant fashion, right? Then when you write the A's in terms of B's,
yes,
you will find that it doesn't depend on B tilde 1, right? In particular, if O's are F mu's, you will find that once you have substitute for A mu as in terms of B tilde 1's, right, O's will be independent of B tilde 1, and that should happen automatically, right? Because the gauge transformation from here, you see that delta B tilde 1
is equal to
this, nothing else changes, right? So then if something is gauge invariant, if something doesn't change under a change like this, okay, that means that doesn't change under an arbitrary variation of B tilde 1. Okay. And hence it must be independent of B tilde 1. Right? That's the logic.
So here we use the gauge independence of O operators, right?
Yes.
But did we use gauge independence of S anywhere?
Yes, you did. Because otherwise, if S dependent on if S was not gauge invariant, again we couldn't have factored out from the numerator and the denominator.
So, because in the denominator also we have S.
That is true. But here you have, say, suppose you have a B tilde 1 integral, okay, into the IS. Okay. That S could depend on B tilde 1. Suppose it depends on the product B tilde 1 times B tilde 2. Right? Then you couldn't just factor, right? These depend on B tilde 2, right? These depends on B tilde 1 and B tilde 2. These, we are doing the integral about B tilde 1. So there is nothing that you can factor out and cancel. Okay? So it is necessary that this is really independent of B tilde 1. Okay? So the B tilde 1 integral is identical in the numerator and the denominator, and they factor out. Is that clear? Okay? And the reason is that it's not that S, if S are dependent on, as a sum of one term which depends on B tilde 1 and no other B tildes, and another term which depends only on the other B tildes, then what you are saying is possible, you could just factor out. Okay? But in general, S is not of that kind. Right? S may depend on B tilde 1 and B tilde 2, cross product. And in which case, there is no way to factor out anything from the numerator, unless it becomes independent of B tilde 1.
Plus
Yeah, it will not be gauge invariant, but at least you could factor out. So what he is saying is that if this had the structure that it has a piece which depends only on B tilde 1, okay, and nothing else, and then there it has a piece that doesn't depend on B tilde 1, then you could factor out the B tilde 1 dependence.
But that's never going to happen, right? Because for loading the invariant object, you need to...
Yeah, so typically that never happens, right? Typically there is always a cross term. Okay, so this is the general situation. Okay, that it either becomes totally independent of the B tilde 1, which is the condition of gauge invariance, right? Or it depends on everything. Okay, are there other questions?
Sir, we are choosing the B because of the gauge freedom. We are using the gauge freedom?
We have not done anything up to this stage. We have not done anything. This you could do even in a, if you didn't have gauge invariance. I'm just changing variables from A tilde mu to B tilde mu, right? I mean, if in a normal theory without gauge invariance, you did this, you'll get identical answer to what you had before, right? Because you're just making a change of variables, right? Doesn't matter what you do, okay? In going from here to there, okay, in dropping the S equal to 1 term, you are using gauge invariance. Okay? Otherwise, the B tilde 1 integral doesn't factor from the rest. Right? So you couldn't just cancel the B tilde 1 integral between numerator and denominator. Right? That's where gauge invariance is coming in. And it's important that not just the action is gauge invariant, but also that the operators whose expectation value you are trying to calculate are also gauge invariant. Is this point here? Okay, it's only under those conditions that you can factor out the B tilde 1 integral. Up to this point, we have never used gauge invariance anywhere. Okay, this is just a simple change of variables. Yes.
If you are doing this thing in the transform domain, the momentum space, basically. So, there was a Jacobian actually involved in transformation, right?
Yes.
So there will be Minkowski integral also in the
integral.
So, that factors out?
Yes, there is no Minkowski integral. For every k, there is Jacobian. So, that will come as a product. See, this path integral, right, there is a hidden product over each k, right? Because you are making this change of s, this is a path integral, right? So for each s, there is an infinite dimensional set, infinite set of integrals, right? One for each k. So this Jacobian factor will multiply each of those, okay? But nevertheless, that's just a constant that is independent of the B tilde s case, right? It's field independent. It of course changes from one k to another k. Okay, but you are not doing any integral over k here. Yeah? These integrals are over h field. So that's why that factors out. Okay? K, you just think of as an index. Okay, that labels these various fields. Is that clear? Okay, so factoring the Jacobian is possible because that doesn't depend on the fields. Okay, and the fields are the ones that are integrating over. Yeah? You are not integrating over k here. Okay, so once we have this, now we can evaluate this, okay, by substituting for S, we know the expression for S, right? Maxwell's action, minus 1 quarter F mu, okay. A mu you know in terms of the B tildes, so you can substitute, and you can write, get an action that involves quadratic and B tilde S. Is that clear? But this now involves only 3 variables, not 4. Okay. So the matrix that you are going to get is a 3x3 matrix. Okay? And you can easily convince yourself that that matrix is invertible. Okay, I'll leave as an exercise to check that the new kinetic operator, new 3x3 kinetic operator, is invertible. Okay, so you can define a propagator. Okay, but now the propagator is a 3x3 matrix. Okay, which is okay because once you take these O tilde i's, okay, here also functions are only those three variables, right, not four. Okay, they are gauge invariant objects, so they have never involved the B tilde 1 component. So now you can carry out the usual manipulation, okay, as you do in path integral, to evaluate any correlation function that you want. Is that point clear? Okay. So I leave this as an exercise. Compute this is a reasonably simple calculation. All you have to do is that you have to express this F tilde mu nus in terms of the BSS, B tilde SS. Okay, each F tilde mu nu will be some linear combination of the three B tilde S. That's clear? Right? It's F tilde mu nu. F tilde mu nu is I times k mu A tilde nu minus k nu A tilde nu. Okay. In place of A tilde mu, we substitute sum over S ES nu of k. Okay, once you have chosen a particular set of ES mu of k, it is straightforward. Okay, in fact, much of the calculation you should be able to do without choosing any specific basis. So you substitute here.
So we can use the k square equals to 0.
No, no. No, certainly not. Because that is an on-shell condition. Right? You are not going to use k square equal to 0. This is two-point Green's function that you are trying to calculate. So no k square equal to 0 condition, because of course for k square equal to 0 we expect a pole anyway, right? Even scalar field propagator has a pole at k square plus m square equal to 0. Okay? So that is for a general k. Okay? So don't use any specific choice of basis till you have to do this maybe till the end. Okay? So what will happen here is that when you substitute
s goes from 1 to 3, 2 to 4.
Okay.
3, 4, right?
No, s goes from 1 to 4. To begin with, right? To begin with, S goes from 1 to 4, right? Once you substitute, because this is gauge invariant, right, you should find that the B1 drops out, okay? Which is not very hard to see, right? Because the corresponding coefficient is ES mu, right? If you take ES mu is K mu, right? So you'll get a K nu minus K nu, K mu, right? That will just drop out, that will vanish. So it will actually be a function of only between the 2, 3 and 4. So now, you just think of the B tilde 2, 3 and 4 as your basic variables and just repeat whatever we did, okay, for a general set of fields. Okay, we had this M mu nu, if you remember that A may B, right? A may B phi tilde B, that was the set of kinetic terms, and then if you have products of the phi's, right, we derive how to, we discuss how to derive the Feynman rules. Okay? You just follow that procedure, okay, except that the variables are now these B tildes. So now we can calculate a two-point function of B tilde S prime. Okay. Once you have calculated a two-point function, you just substitute F tilde in terms of the B's to calculate a two-point function of the F tilde. Is this procedure clear? Okay, so I'll leave this as an exercise. The only tricky part here is that you have this 3 by 3 matrix, right? The entries of this 3 by 3 matrix will involve this ESS, right? Which you have to then invert, right? So one way to do this is that you choose some specific E's and then invert, okay? But there are also general tricks by which you can write down the inverse, okay, in terms of the original E's, okay, by using appropriate constraints, okay? in any case, the final result for this two-point function, okay, the if this object should not depend on the choice of the yields. Because choice of the yields was up to you, right? Okay, for any choice of you, you should get the same answer. Okay, so this is one consistency check that you should be able to see, verify at the end, that while the two-point function of the b tilde s, b tilde s k, b tilde s prime k prime, that two-point function of course will depend on the choice of the yields. Because the definition of the b tilde s depends on the choice of the yields. But this one should not depend on the choice of the yields. Okay, and this should come out automatically from the calculation. Is this okay? Okay, so later on we'll do a much more general version of this, where we will also have interactions built in. And there you will see that you also have to worry about the Jacobian that you pick up when you make change of variables like this. It will not be simple linear change of variables of the kind that you have described here. Okay, so our goal now will be to generalize Maxwell's theory. What we have done so far is a very simple version, okay, which is a free Maxwell's theory. We will try to generalize it not just to interacting Maxwell's theory, okay, which will of course be part of this, but also for a more general class of theories. So for this, let's just recall one way by which you can arrive at Maxwell's action, okay, or the Maxwell's theory. And this is by trying to make sure that the interaction of a charged particle, okay, with gauge fields is gauge invariant. Okay. So let me recall some of the details. Okay. So consider a free Dirac field. Okay. Consider a free Dirac formula. Okay, I could have also replaced this by the scalar. It doesn't really matter, as you will see. So there it saw psi bar, the action was integral d4x. Was free Maxwell's action. Now you can easily convince yourself that this is invariant, this action is invariant. When I write a transformation like this, it goes to. When I write transformation like this, this means that this holds for every component of psi. Okay. So, in component form, I can also write psi alpha of x. Okay, so, this is the same as saying that psi alpha of x goes to the I lambda times psi alpha of x. Okay, here I am just thinking of this as a column vector. Okay, four dimensional column vector, and we just multiply each of the elements of a column vector by to the I lambda. Is this clear? Now, to see that this action is invariant is easy. You multiply psi by e to the I alpha. Then e to the I alpha of course can be taken here because just a overall phase. Psi bar goes to e to the minus I alpha of psi. So I can write psi bar of x goes to e to the minus I alpha of psi. Psi bar. Sorry. And then this lambda cancels this lambda. Now suppose that we want to make this lambda dependent on the coordinates. So if lambda is a function of x, then this invariance is no longer true. Okay? It's no longer true because you can see that now del mu psi goes to del mu of e to the I lambda of x times psi x, which has a piece which is e to the I lambda of x times del mu psi of x plus I del mu lambda of x times e to the I lambda of x times psi of x. So then when you have this term, psi bar gets multiplied by e to the minus I lambda as this has no derivative exactly for it. So as far as this term is concerned, it's nice because e to the minus I lambda will cancel this e to the I lambda. Okay, so that will give you back psi bar of I gamma mu del mu psi. The problem is with this term. Right? This term doesn't cancel with anything else. Is that clear? Okay. So because this term doesn't cancel with anything else, you have to see if we can do something to cancel this term. And what you normally do in electrodynamics is to define a covariant derivative. Okay, introduce a new field, okay, which is a gauge field, and define a covariant derivative, which by construction cancels this term. Okay. So what we do is that we define d mu of psi as del mu of psi minus I a mu of psi, I a mu psi is a new field. And postulate a new symmetric transformation. Postulate that when you transform psi by e to the I lambda of x times psi, when lambda becomes function of x, we take a mu to a mu plus del mu lambda. Now you see that d mu psi goes to del mu psi, you have already seen, that goes to e to the I lambda times del mu psi plus I del mu lambda times psi, that's del mu psi term, and then this one goes to minus I a mu of x goes to a mu plus del mu lambda, and psi goes to e to the I lambda times psi. So now you see that this term cancels this term. And what you'll get is e to the I lambda times
del mu psi minus I a mu psi e to the I lambda times d mu psi.
So when we consider now this new action,
this is invariant, this guy is invariant.
Okay. But the price that we have paid is that we have introduced a new field, A mu. And by construction, you have adjusted the transformation of mu in such a way that the action becomes gauge invariant. But once you have introduced a new field, you have to introduce its kinetic term. Right? Otherwise, this theory doesn't make sense. Right? You have to do integration or path integral over mu. In that process, you have to, you need a quadratic term. Okay, that you have to add to the action. And now you have to worry whether you can find a quadratic term involving a mu, which is also gauge invariant. Right? We have made sure that this is invariant. Right? But if you cannot find a quadratic term, okay, which is gauge invariant, then you are in trouble. Right? Then you are not getting a gauge invariant action. Okay? So, how to construct a quadratic term in a mu?
How to construct a gauge invariant
the AMU. Yeah, so forget about that AMU, right? Now we are saying that, I mean, we want to see, I mean, we did work with Maxwell's action. Okay, now what we are saying is that let's imagine that we didn't knew nothing about the Maxwell's action. Okay, is there a way, okay, that we can motivate ourselves to writing down a Maxwell's action? Okay, so now you are saying that let's start from the free Dirac action. Okay, you could have also started with the free scalar field action. That action has a symmetry, right? This phase symmetry. Okay. We want to see if it's possible to make that phase symmetry into a local symmetry. Okay, where the phase changes as a function of x. Okay. And what we find is that you can make it into a local symmetry, but the price is that you have to introduce an extra field, which is called a mu, which has a certain transformation law. Okay. And now you want to see how to write down an action for a mu itself. Okay, forgetting about psi, which will be the analog of the kinetic term for a mu. Right? So you are trying to arrive at a Maxwell's action by some logical procedure, right? So that's the idea. Now in this case, of course, you can do it by inspection, right? If you know that a mu, if it goes like this, okay, then if you define f mu, which is the curl, okay, that's gauge invariant. Okay? And hence it will automatically give you a gauge invariant object. So the square of that is gauge invariant. Right, and that is the standard Maxwell's action that you are familiar with. Okay. However, keeping in mind that you have to eventually generalize it, okay, we'll discuss now a more systematic procedure for arriving at an action of that kind. Okay. Our goal is to arrive at Maxwell's action, but we want to see that here it's easy to see by inspection that this is from this we can define it. Okay, but sometimes you will see that it's not so easy to do it by inspection. Okay, so let's try to see if there is a general procedure that we can use. Is this logic clear? Okay, so what you are doing here is trivial for Maxwell's action, right? Nobody will do it like this for Maxwell's action, but this will be useful for later. No, it need not be unique, right? In which case we have one of the choices, right? In fact, typically it's not unique. Okay? But if you further demand, for example, that this has only two derivatives, then it becomes unique. Okay, sometimes you can write the other terms with higher number of derivatives.
Is there some condition for being a kinetic term? That's what
I'm asking. Yeah. So typically the condition for having a calling it a kinetic term, it should have that it should have two derivatives of the fields. Okay? Then you can show that it becomes unique. Up to normalization. Okay, so you have seen that d mu psi goes to e to the I lambda of x times d mu psi. Okay. So what about d mu psi? What will it go to? So you can do it in two steps. First, is the d nu psi goes to e to the I lambda of x times d nu psi. That's the way we have defined our d nu. Okay? So the d nu psi just picks up a phase. But once you have this relation, you can treat this. Okay, forget about the fact that it's d nu psi, okay, it's transformation order exactly that like that of psi. So the same logic that we used here, okay, what was the ingredient here, right? In showing that d mu lambda transforms this way. That psi transforms by a phase. Psi picks up into the I lambda phase, right? That was the only ingredient in deriving this. Now because d nu psi has exactly the same property that it just picks up this phase into the I lambda of x, we can repeat the same argument, okay, our same analysis, so that this should go as e to the I lambda f x. So once d mu acts on this, this should go to e to the I lambda of x times d mu d mu psi. Is this point clear? Okay, so let me be maybe make it a little more specific. So we are trying to calculate this d prime mu psi prime. Okay. Why d prime? Because d has inside it an a, right? So a has gone to a prime, okay, and psi has gone to psi prime. Okay, so let me write psi prime is e to the I lambda times psi, and a prime mu is a mu plus del mu lambda. Now we use the fact that this d nu prime psi prime is e to the I lambda of x times d nu psi. And then we use the fact that d prime mu of anything which has a form e to the I lambda of x times the original variable, okay, by the same repeating this argument again, that this should be given by d mu or e to the I lambda d mu of this quantity, which is d mu psi. So that's the logic. Okay. That once you know d nu psi transforms in the same way as psi, we can keep repeating this. Okay, however many times you apply covariant derivative, it will always become an overall phase. It will be I lambda of x and then the same covariant derivatives. Is this clear? Well, this is a simple statement, but it will be very useful in more complicated cases. Now, by the same logic, d mu psi should also go to e to the I lambda times d mu psi. Just change mu and nu on both sides. So this means that if you take the commutator, d mu minus d mu, this will go to e to the I lambda . Is this clear? Now let's try to evaluate what this object is, d mu psi minus d mu psi. What does this mean? So this is del mu minus, I call this minus or plus, del mu minus a mu,
minus
del mu minus a mu on del mu psi minus a mu psi.
I
m, there's an I. Right? So let's apply this first derivative on this thing. So this gives you del mu psi minus I del mu psi minus I minus I a nu del mu psi a mu del mu psi minus I a nu minus a mu psi, and then subtract from this term value and you have to exchange. Is this clear? But now you see that some terms cancel, because here you have a nu del mu psi, a mu del mu psi, both with the same sign. So when you add these two, this is symmetric under mu nu exchange. Right? These two together is symmetric under mu nu exchange. You are subtracting from this the term where mu and nu have been exchanged. So these terms just cancel. Is that clear? A mu del mu psi plus a nu del mu psi, okay, minus the same thing with mu nu exchange is cancels. Similarly, this term cancels. A nu term cancels. This term also cancels. Del mu minus del mu del. The only term that remains is this one. Right? Is that clear? So that's
minus I.
So we
learn that d mu psi minus d mu psi is minus I f mu nu. That f mu nu is del mu del nu minus del mu. So now let's combine the information that we had here with the information that we have here. Okay. So suppose we didn't know how F transforms. Suppose F mu nu goes to F prime mu nu under Gauss transformation. Okay, let's imagine that we don't know how F mu nu transforms.
Why is there an I there?
Pardon?
I. I F mu nu.
I. Oh, because there's an I here. And this I has gone.
Oh, achcha.
Right? This minus I has basically gone there, otherwise it's del mu nu minus del mu. So suppose f mu nu goes to f prime, okay, we don't know what it is. Now we know that the left hand side goes to e to the I lambda times this. Okay? So e to the I lambda times d mu
minus d mu
psi equal to minus I f prime mu nu. F prime mu nu, the important point here is that this is not a differential operator. Okay? This is just some function. Okay? Where d mu, inside d mu, these are differential operators. Right? This was acting on everything that is on the right. Okay? This is as f mu nu. Okay, just a multiplicative function. So this is minus I f prime mu nu times e to the I lambda times psi. But the left hand side is e to the I lambda f mu nu of psi. Whereas d nu minus d nu is f mu nu. Is this clear what we are doing? We are using this relation, okay, and we are using the relation that d nu psi minus d nu psi, okay, under a transformation, okay, becomes e to the I lambda times d nu psi minus d nu psi. These two informations you are combining together. Okay, so maybe I can do it in two steps. Okay, again, this is somewhat trivial for QED, okay, but it will be useful later. So we have this relation, d nu psi minus d nu psi is minus I f mu nu of psi, f mu nu times psi. This is the first relation. Second relation that we have is that d prime mu psi prime minus d prime mu psi prime is given by minus I, is given by e to the I lambda times d nu psi minus d nu. That came from here. Okay, that is this statement that when you transform everything to prime variables, that just picks up the same phase e to the I lambda times the unprime variables. So now let's combine this with what you have here.
So this now I can write as minus I f prime mu nu psi prime. Okay, everything written in the prime variables. This one I can write as e to the I lambda times minus I f mu nu psi. Then I just put the e to the I lambda and then I use the fact that this is given by minus I f mu nu psi. Right?
I'm just looking at the LHS of 2.
I'm looking at LHS and RHS of 2. Both LHS and RHS, I'm simplifying using this. Right? Using this, I simplify the LHS by replacing this f and size by the prime values. Right? And using this, I replace the RHS by again replacing this in terms of the unprime values. Right? That's what I'm doing. Okay? Both in left hand side and right hand side of the second equation, I'm making use of this one. Is this clear? Yeah, I'm making use of the first one, but first one is also valid in the prime coordinate system, right? Because it's valid in general. Okay, the fact that this is true, if you had replaced mu by mu prime and psi by psi prime, that's just simple, right? It will still hold. But now we use the fact that psi prime itself is e to the I lambda psi, right? And we compare the two, that gives you f prime mu nu equal to f mu nu. Okay, it seems like a lot of work to prove something that we already knew. Okay, the f mu nu is gauge invariant. Okay, but this is one way to prove this, and we'll see later why this is useful. But is this derivation clear? Okay. That what we do is that we take the commutator between d mu and d nu. Okay. Use the fact that the commutator is just an ordinary multiplicative operator. It's not a differential operator. Okay. Because it's an ordinary multiplicative operator. Okay. Multiplication by f mu nu. Okay. As far as the commutator is concerned, multiplying psi by e to the I lambda. Okay. It doesn't matter whether you multiply here or multiply here. E to the I lambda just moves through without any problem. Okay. Using that, okay, we use the second relation. Okay, this is the transformation law, and this is the first relation. That fact that the commutator is just a function multiplying psi, okay, to find the relationship between f prime and f. So once we know that f is gauge invariant, you can now write an action for the gauge field. So, S. Maxwell you can write as 1 over E square. I can put a normality factor minus 1 cross rho over e square f mu nu. So f mu nu, this is because f mu nu is gauge invariant, this is also gauge invariant manifestly. E is a constant. Okay, I have chosen to parameterize in this way. Yes. Yes. D mu prime, D nu prime, psi prime. No, see, this equation you agree? What we put later, you don't worry, right? That we have already argued that the transform of D nu psi is e to the I lambda times d mu d nu psi, right? So d nu prime psi prime, that's the transform of d nu psi, right? That should be e to the I lambda times d nu psi, right? Similarly, this is just the exchange of mu and nu.
right? So it's transformed d mu prime psi prime is just e to the I lambda times d mu psi. These ones? No. No, because you are, this is a transformed side, this is the untransformed side. This is the one that we have transformed, right? Exactly, yeah. So this is my left hand side, this is my right hand side, right? This is equation 2. So left hand side is the transformed one, right hand side is the untransformed one, and we use the fact that under a transformation, d mu psi just picks up a phase into the I lambda. Right? That's what we are using. Is this clear? Okay. So this is then the most general action, gauge invariant action that you can write down, which has only two derivatives. Okay. F mu has one derivative of mu. Right? So this has two derivatives. So this is the form of the gauge invariant action. Okay. And now you can go to the more conventional form. Okay. By absorbing, you can write, define A mu over E, okay, as some mu vector. Let's call this B mu. Then this E will go away. Right? Then this becomes minus 1/4 integral del mu v mu minus del mu v mu times del mu v mu. But now the definition of v mu psi becomes del mu psi, because it was minus I A mu psi, right? In terms of B, this becomes del mu psi minus I E mu psi. This is probably more familiar from the covariant derivative, right? Because you also, the covariant derivative d mu is normally called del mu minus I times the charge that the field carries time times a mu. That a mu is now b mu. So basically, it's more convenient from the perspective that we are working in to not have any coupling constant in the definition of the b mu. Okay, d mu will just contain the gauge field a mu. And then you put the constant in normalization. If you want, you can remove it from the normalization and put it in the definition of the covariant derivative. But this is a more standard form that we'll be using. Okay, but it's entirely equivalent. Okay, you can choose to normalize this by absorbing E, and then you'll get some E over here.
Sir, do you know this construct, like if you by taking this commutator just from looking at its transformation properties under
it? Yes. No, we'll see what happens. It's not guaranteed to give gauge invariant object, right? We'll basically follow the same logic, okay, and we'll see under what condition it doesn't give a gauge invariant object. Okay, but it will give something close to gauge invariant. Okay, that's why you are introducing this.
It will be always a multiplicative one.
It will be always a multiplicative one, right? Because basically what we'll find, that's like here you saw that it's a multiplicative factor. Yeah. In general, it will not have a derivative, right? D mu as an is an operator. It is a derivative, right? D mu also is a derivative, right? It has two derivatives. But the general feature that is relevant here is that when you take a commutator of the two, okay, the derivative terms are cancelled out, right? It will be just a multiplicative factor, okay, on the field. Right? That's what you are using here, right? Here, for example, the commutator becomes just a multiplicative factor f mu nu multiplied psi. Is this clear? Yes, of course.
So, how is this a proof of the gauge invariance of f mu nu? You already knew the transformation of f mu nu. You would have proved it by
like. Yes, I agree. So, this is just a different way of looking at it. But once I have defined f mu nu, right, as by this, Of course, I could prove it by looking at the transformation of A, B. Right? So this is not giving us anything new. Right? It's just one way of looking at this, which will be useful later. Okay, where the standard transformation rule of A mu will be somewhat different, okay, and there finding the transformation of F mu nu will be more complicated. Okay, at the level of the Maxwell's theory, it has no new content at all. Is this clear? We are just re-deriving the same result, right? Which we could have trivially derived because A mu goes to A mu plus del nu epsilon, right? So del nu term will just cancel out. So the fact that the F mu is gauge invariant is trivial, and we are just proving the same trivial result using this procedure. Is this clear?
The factor in the action minus 1 over 4 is chosen so as to reproduce the Maxwell's equation?
Yes. I mean, that's all you could absorb inside E.
Yeah. Right?
So all you know is that you could have multiplied this action by some arbitrary constant. Right? That arbitrary constant I have chosen to call 1 over 4 E square. Right, it's just pure convention, right? So that I'll now absorb E into the definition of the gauge field, and then I'll get the standard normalization. Okay. The important point is there is only one parameter that you can introduce here, which is this factor over here. Okay. For Maxwell's action, in fact, you have more choices, but we'll discuss it when you consider the general case. Questions?
Why a quadratic term is necessary? I'm not a physicist. I mean, the previous one was also doing like pi psi, psi over a derivative psi, that was also doing. So, why it be necessary?
The point is now, once you have introduced a new field, we have to do a path integral over psi and a. Right? So you can do the integral over psi using that quadratic term, but not the integral over A. Right? So to have a well-defined path integral over A, we need a quadratic term for it. Right? So that's the idea. Okay, so now I'll introduce the problem and maybe we'll discuss it in more extensively next time. So we again consider a set of three Dirac fermions, but instead of considering one fermion, okay, let's consider n Dirac fermions. Okay. So take n Dirac fermions, each of mass m. And take the action, which is integral d4x. This is summed over k equal to 1 to n. Now, to simplify the notation, psi is already a column vector, right? Four-dimensional column vector. So let's think of this as a 4n-dimensional column vector, psi. Because each psi k has four components, k runs over n values. Let's think of this as a 4n-dimensional column vector and write this as integral d4x, psi bar. Where psi is like psi k, psi, let's call it psi 1 alpha, then some psi 2 alpha. Yeah,
psi, I'll write psi 1 1 up to psi 1 4, then psi 2 1 up to psi 2 4, and finally psi n 1 up to psi n 4. This is the way we think of psi as a 4 n dimensional column.
Then, sir, how to multiply psi 1?
Yeah, I'm going to, I have to define what gamma means now. Okay, psi is this one. Okay, so if I use this rotation, then any matrix that multiplies it should also be thought of as a 4n by 4n matrix, right? Not by 4 by 4 matrix. Okay? So this gamma mu now have to say what these are. Right? This is identity. Okay? M times identity, that's the 4n by 4n identity matrix. So this gamma mu, I have to think of this as gamma mu as a block diagonal matrix 4 by 4, 4 by 4, 4 by 4 up to 4 by 4. That becomes 4n by 4n. Is this clear? So with this notation, this is the same as this one. It's clear, because for each k, okay, so k equal to 1, that means that you are taking this product in the first 4 dimensional block. Okay, and because this is block diagonal, there is no mixing between different blocks. Okay, so what we have here, okay, psi k bar I gamma mu del mu minus m psi k, in this notation, is identical. Is this point clear? That a gamma matrix should be thought of as some kind of tensor product of gamma mu with identity. Okay, that's what this is saying. Okay, so let me write it here. Gamma mu's go to gamma mu times identity. Okay, so this tensor product basically means this. Okay, that you take the identity n by n identity matrix, so let me call this I n by n. These are 4 by 4. So you take a n by n identity matrix and replace each one in the entry by gamma mu. Right. So n by n identity matrix becomes 4n by 4n matrix. Is this clear? Now you notice that this action is invariant under the following transformation. Where u dagger u is identity. This is not difficult to see. Okay, let's look at it in this form. So s goes to integral d4x. Yes. No, right now it's n by n. I've written it in the component notation. Okay. Later on we'll try to make it in the 4n by 4n and we'll see how we do this. So this is sum over k, u star k l psi by l. You agree with that? When you go from psi to psi bar, okay, there are these products of gamma, etc., right? But what is important here is that u gets complex conjugated, u star kl. Okay, the gamma matrices of course are acting exactly for in the same way for each k. Okay, so u star kl psi bar l, then I gamma mu del mu minus m. Times u k, it's called s psi s.
So now you are thinking of this as a four dimensional column vector. Each psi s, psi k as four dimensional column vectors.
But L and S are not the scalar
integers,
right?
No, no. These are running over L values. So k, L, s runs all the way from 1 to n. These are not spinor indices. Okay, spinor indices are hidden. Is that clear? Now this you can easily see is the original one, because sum over k, sum over k, u star k l, u k s, is delta L s from this relation. U star k l is u dagger, so this you can write as sum over k, u dagger l k, u k s. That's u dagger u, the L s element. Right, that's delta L s. Is this clear? So sum over k has already been performed. Because of the delta L s, you set L s equal to L. So this just becomes integral d 4 x sum over L equal to 1 to n psi bar L I gamma mu L mu minus m psi L, which is the original action. Just rename L as k. U's are not yet function of x. Is this okay? Now, we can make this into this 4n by 4n notation. If you use this notation, in 4n by 4n matrix notation, this transformation that we have written here, I can write psi goes to 2 psi. Now, this will be a 4n by 4n matrix. And now, can you tell me what this 4n by 4n matrix is? Suppose the original matrix, n by n matrix U is given. How will you construct this 4n by 4n matrix? Just like gamma. So let's see how. Yes. You have an n by n matrix, right? Yes. So what you are looking for here, earlier you have said something like this, right? Now you want these to be 4 by 4 identity. This doesn't act on the spinor space, right? Times AUN, right? That's what you are looking for. But as a matrix, what is it? What will you do to write a 4 by 4 n by 4 n matrix? Yes, it will not act on the psi bars and psi's in the spinor indices. Or another way of saying it, it should act as an identity on the spinor indices.
Some block diagonal identity, no, not block diagonal, but 4 by 4 identity.
Yes, how will you put that 4 by 4 identity? You have a matrix U, which is n by n. Yeah, U dagger U, of course, U is as an n by n matrix that satisfies that, right? Well, then it will give a general 4n by 4n dimensional identity matrix, unitary matrix, and you don't want that.
Log
diagonal 4, but 4 by 4 matrices are not UN.
So, each 4 by 4 block will be some U11 times 4 by 4 identity.
Yes. So, that's the point. So, you have to now write the U first. See, what we did was that we wrote the identity first, right? I n by n, and replaced each of the ones by the gamma, right? So, the convention that I have chosen. This matrix you have to write first, okay? And then whatever is in the product to it, you replace the elements of the matrix, the n by n matrix, by that thing, right? So I wrote identity first and then I wrote gamma, right? So here also, okay, you write the n by n matrix first, right? So that's U11, U12, U13, and so on. U21, U22, and so on, right? And then you replace each of these by what you are tensoring with. In this case, you are tensoring with I. Right? So it's I4 by 4. So it's each entry is like a 4 by 4 matrix, okay, proportional to 4 by 4 identity matrix. And you multiply this by U11.
So the different U is within two different spinors.
Exactly. Okay, the U's you can easily verify that if you use this, right, the U's don't mix the indices within defined spinors. So that those are just identity. Right? It just multiplies the corresponding index by U. Is this point clear?
You do the same thing if you take a 4 cross 4 I. For each one, you put a U and in at each one. Would that be the same?
No, it will not be the same. Because we have already chosen a convention. You see, we have already chosen a convention that the first matrix, n by n matrix that we'll write, okay, that is the one we'll write first. And then make each element into 4 by 4 blocks, right? Otherwise, you have to change the convention here. Okay. Once you have chosen the convention there, okay. Otherwise, here the convention would have been that you write a 4 by 4 gamma matrix, okay. Then each element you make it into n by n identity matrix. That's not the way you have chosen this convention, right? The way you choose the convention is that you first write the identity matrix and then make each of them into gamma. Okay. So, with that, you have to write this matrix first. And then expand each element of this by whatever appears here. So if we had an operator like gamma mu u, how will you represent this? Gamma mu is acting on the spinor index, u is acting on the vector index, the n by n dimension index, right? So what will be the representation of this? Gamma mu 4 cross 4. Yes, but tensor product, I want to write every explicit components.
First you have to write the U, then
by come on, exactly. So you write the U first, right? See, it's just a pure convention. I could have chosen to write the gamma mu first, right? And then expand each of them into U's. But you have to stick to a given convention, right? We have used a convention that we write the U first, right? And the n by n thing first, and then expand each of them into these gammas. Okay, so when I write gamma mu u, right, you should really think of this as a matrix in 4n by 4n matrix. Okay. If you don't believe this, so what we can do is that we write gamma mu, representation of gamma mu first, represent the u first, and the multiply. Yeah, that is a
that is a possibility. So let's do that. So what are the representation of gamma mu? It was gamma mu, right? These are each 4 by 4. And then you had n by n. Okay? What is the representation of u? u11 times i4. Multiply it, okay, just matrix multiplication, 4n by 4n matrix to 4n by 4n matrix. You can easily convince yourself that this should be like gamma mu 4 by 4, it multiplies I 4 by 4, right? So it just becomes u11, this is just number, u11 times gamma mu 4 by 4, u12 times gamma mu 4 by 4, and so on. And you can also say that u and gamma mu common, u gamma mu, whether you calculate u gamma mu or gamma mu u. Is the same. Okay, if you have multiplied by this matrix from the right, okay, it would be exactly identical.
This is
yes, exactly. That's right. Okay. So these are just some notations. Okay, I could have write everything in components, okay, which would be perfectly fine, but this notation is useful. And you can also check that with this notation, u dagger u is identity 4n by 4n. So this is true as a 4n by 4n matrix. So this was the representation of u, right? So as long as this use as an n by n matrix satisfies that condition, u dagger u equal to identity. As a 4n by 4n matrix, also it will satisfy the same condition. Is that obvious? Okay, if it's not obvious, just write in components and you will find that this is true. Okay. So in component, this means that we are representing u now. We are representing u as ui alpha j beta, okay, matrix has this structure, I runs from 1 to n, alpha runs from 1 to 4, and similarly for j and beta. For the matrix u, this is just uij times delta alpha beta. On the other hand, for gamma mu, I alpha j beta is delta ij gamma mu alpha. Okay, this is the explicit component representation of these matrices. Is this here? Pardon? Index? Yeah, so the first index should be 4n indices, right? This is a 4n by 4n matrix. So the 4n indices I am writing as a pair I alpha, I runs from 1 to n, alpha runs from 1 to 4. So that take this take combination takes 4n values. Right? This combination also takes 4n values. And what I am saying is a 4n by 4n matrix representation of this u, right, which acts trivially on the spinor space, is this one. The 4n by 4n matrix representation of gamma mu, which acts on the spinor space, but which acts trivially on the n-dimensional space, is this one. When you take the matrix product, you have to take the last pair of indices of this one with the first pair of indices of the second matrix that you're multiplying by, and contract accordingly. Okay. So m I alpha j beta. Sorry, Mn. Suppose you have Mn. You
then trying to calculate I alpha j beta. M and N are 4n by 4n matrices. This can be written as M I alpha k gamma n k gamma j beta. Okay, this k gamma indices have to be contracted. Okay, instead of having one index, we are thinking of this as a pair of indices, right? Labeling the row vector and the column vector. Okay. So these are the 4n indices that we are summing over. Is that clear? Yeah, this is the notation. So with this notation, let me write the action again and then I'll stop. The action that we wrote earlier, now I can read it as phi bar I gamma mu del mu minus n psi, but with the understanding that psi and psi bar are now 4n by 4n column vector. Okay, this is just I fully identified in my process. So the problem that we'll be interested in next time, okay, is to see how we can make this invariant under the same kind of symmetry that we described, psi goes to u psi, okay? But this time u becomes a function of x. Okay, this will be the generalization of the problem that we solved earlier. So now we want to make it invariant. So problem is to make it invariant under that u of x will have this structure u11 of x times identity u12 of x times identity and so on. And this matrix u11x, u12x, etc., u11 u12x. So this is now an n by n matrix. This is n matrix. Okay, we don't take u to be an arbitrary 4n by 4n unitary matrix. That will be too big. We want to find an action which is invariant under the transformation of this kind, where u of x for each x is in a un matrix. Okay, in this sense. Okay, that u of course is a 4n by 4n matrix, but when you consider this n by n matrix by replacing the identities by 1, okay, this should be a unitary matrix. Is this question clear? Okay, now you may want to ask why you want to do this. The only answer is that this is what describes nature, right? Now, why it describes nature, nobody knows. Okay, but this is the kind of theory that you have to develop to describe nature. Okay, and that's why we will try to see how to make this work. Okay, so we'll, next week the classes will be at the regular period, so Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, 2 to 4.